This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Tell you something, and not a lot of people know this.
Mm-hmm.
We are clinging to the surface of this planet while it spins through space at 1,000 miles an hour, held only by the mystery force called gravity.
Wow.
A lot of people panic when you tell them that and they just fall off.
Oh.
But I see you're not falling off. That means you've got the hang of it. That means that you have got
natural ability.
Yeah.
In a Scottish town, a school football team's teenage goalkeeper is attracted to a girl who, to his amazement, is a talented striker. In Gregory's Girl, a 1980 Scottish film that we'll be discussing on episode 34 of Go Home in a Box. The 34th episode, Joel. We've made it. And
we're old.
Yeah, and I've already sort of introduced him, my co-host on this trek, the Ayatollah of pop culture, so to speak, Mr. Joel of Puma.
Oh, thank you for that, Chris. Giving me that title makes my fascination with coming-of-age films seem less seedy than it really is.
Yes, so yeah, we're talking coming-of-age films inspired by one of this year's Best Picture Oscar nominees, Lady Bird, on our last show, when we discussed Invasion of the Body Snatchers and Shivers, we were comparing themes to current Oscar contenders. We picked Get Out with the previous show. This time out, we're going with Lady Bird, a film I have not seen. Let me ask you, Joel, have you seen it?
I haven't gotten the chance yet, because apparently more people are willing to raise their hand when you ask, do you want to see Black Panther, than when you ask, do you want to see Lady Bird? So I've seen Black Panther, which I think is about the same, really. But no, I mean, Lady Bird, like, I feel like I know enough about it at this point, have a sense of, like, what it's about and what it appeal is. I mean, I obviously want to see it, but it definitely, I think, it speaks to a very specific kind of female experience that, even though I can appreciate from the outside, I mean, it's probably not going to hit me as hard as, like, you know, honestly, Gregory's Girl does, not in a melancholy way, because it's certainly not a melancholy movie, but
right.
Gregory's Girl, like, and we'll get more into this, but, you know, Gregory's whole development over the course of the film is one I can recognize from being an awkward teenager who, with, you know, no direction and no wisdom whatsoever. Like, Lady Bird, I think, is obviously catering to a different audience with similar themes, but, you know, we don't often see a lot of female-oriented coming-of-age films. Like, the best example I can think of right off the top of my head that's directly female-oriented and not a mixed cast, really, is Little Darlings. And mostly because of music rights issues, that's not even on DVD.
Oh, yeah, Little Darlings with Tatum O'Neal and Christy McNichol, right?
Yeah, and yep. I would actually, TCM plays every now and then. If you get a chance to catch it or find it online through means we shouldn't be talking about, but it's not like anybody's making money off the movie because it uses like a John Lennon song, and Lord knows no one's going to pay for those rights. I'm surprised they haven't just like WKRP in Cincinnati'd it and like just edited out.
Yeah.
or for our wrestling audience, edited out the songs with soundalikes.
Oh yeah, I mean they got the on the Coliseum home video in the vault now, and you know the old classic intro has been edited out. They edited away the old intro music to those Coliseum home videos, man. It's not the same.
It's not the same. Now, it's amazing how much music rights have affected things in the DVD and Blu-ray generations. So Little Darlings, unfortunately, is a bit of a lost film in that sense. Like I said, it does air occasionally on TCM, so if you run into it, do not hesitate to watch it. It's a really interesting little film, and it's one of the only coming-of-age films, which is sad because it's from, like, 1980, coming-of-age films in direct memory that are directly about the female experience and growing up in a really sort of authentic way, in a way that, say, Pretty in Pink and 16 Candles aren't, I don't think.
Yeah, we could have gone with an 80s teen sex comedy, you know that, no? We could have gone with like a Meatballs, or we could have gone with a Porky's. Oh, hey, Porky's would have been a good one.
Oh, you could. Hey, listen, no discussion of Porky's is complete without talking about Porky's for the Atari 2600.
Yeah. I'm sure. You know, and I always wanted that, but of course, I got the hammer come down on that wish list very fast.
And you know, we'll get a bit more into the teen sex comedy a bit, which I think is probably a dead genre at this point, because the new generation of teenagers is just not receptive to, like, those tropes. I mean, quite frankly, the last time we really saw those in earnest was around American Pie, which was when I was a teenager, and even by then, like, even my dumbass at, like, 14 was looking at that stuff and thinking, oh my god, this is so misogynistic.
Yeah,
I mean, the kids today with Tumblr and actual language to describe social issues.
We're in a different era now, and where everything is kind of turning around on its head a little bit and coming back around to bite a lot of people in the ass, and we're looking at a different era in filmmaking, like what quality or actually what the content of those films are. I mean, you could go to any teen sex comedy or slasher film even in the 80s, and you're just going to find a bevy of, you know, naked women. So you're not really going to find that anymore.
Even more than that, like, the stuff that passed for, like, a wacky prank in those, I mean, it's funny we're talking about this because Crack just did an article about the kinds of stuff from the kinds of tropes in teen, like, sex comedies that just don't pass anymore. And, like, there's all these wacky pranks that are just sort of sexual humiliation, and it's like, now that stuff is just considered assault.
Yeah.
Like, the kind of shit in Revenge of the Nerds where you're taking secret photos of topless sorority girls and putting them in a pie. I mean, yeah, I get it. It's a pie, and pies equal wacky comedy. But, like, that kind of stuff, people get prosecuted for now.
Yeah. So we're in a different era of movie making now in terms of that stuff.
It's definitely a evolve or die moment where I don't think Hollywood knows how to reach teenagers except with Marvel movies anymore. So Lady Bird is kind of an interesting placement in that moment, because even though it's sort of set in the past, like, and I feel like its audience is probably not fully teenage, partly because it's sort of a limited release film anyway. Like I see a lot of college age or girls I went to college with who are really, really hyped up about that film because it represents their experience. And, you know, so even Labor might be a bit anachronistic in terms of what, like, I don't think we've really seen, like, the coming of age film that's exact for like kids who are in high school right now.
Right. And so one we're going to talk about to kick it off, of course, is 1980s Gregory's Girl. And this one really is, it's kind of so on point in terms of the teenage experience that it might actually be I know Roger Ebert was one critic who said it might actually be uncomfortable for some teens to watch because it hits so close to home.
I would not disagree. I mean, if you've ever had that moment where you suffered vicarious embarrassment, like, and alongside a character in a movie or TV show, and you had to, like, turn it off or leave the room because you were cringing that hard. Like, Gregory's Girl is an utterly charming film, but it's so authentic to what it's like to be young and awkward that you will suffer.
Yeah, exactly. And let's talk about Gregory's Girl, and we'll go a little in-depth with it here. 1980, I think it had a U.S. release in 81. It's from Scotland, Scottish film, and the version I saw was very Scottish in terms of the accents and how thick they were. There were literally scenes where I had no idea what they were talking about because I couldn't make any of it out. The accents were so thick. But regardless of that, it's written and directed by Bill Forsyth, and I believe this was his second feature film. He had a movie called That Sinking Feeling in 79. No, actually, it was his third. There was Andrina from 81 as well, Gregory's Girl. But his follow-up film after Gregory's Girl, Joel, I think this is a movie you're familiar with, was Local Hero from 1983.
Which I own on VHS.
Oh, proud VHS owner. Yes, join the exclusive club here, Joel. I have several myself.
Bill Forsyth is this is actually a rare episode for us because we're going to be talking about two really critically well-received, renowned films by well-respected filmmakers that are still have a bit of a cult element to them. But yeah, I mean, Forsyth is from that sort of post kitchen sink era of British filmmaking, and not taking that authenticity of those films, but it's not quite as, you know, brooding as those films could be. Stuff like Taste of Honey, Loneliness of a Long Distance Runner, I mean, those were sort of sexual melodramas. And Forsyth, I think, is probably most comparable to Mike Lee that he's doing very down-to-earth slice-of-life films in many of these cases. And
a lot of working-class characters in his films.
And he's also, before he became, before he was doing fictional films, he was doing short documentary films. So that experience really informs his style. I mean, it is a very, it is natural filmmaking in the same sense that in America, you know, Charles Burnett would do, or David Gordon Green early in his career.
Yeah, probably for those who may not be very familiar with Bill Forsyth, probably his best known film on this side of the Atlantic might be 1994's Being Human with Robin Williams. I haven't seen it, but I am familiar with it, and so that would give you an indication of Forsyth's body of work, how he's more into his style is more low-key, more focusing on characters and the drama surrounding them rather than any type of action or anything like that. It's his films are really I guess, like you put it, like more down to earth than most current directors.
Yeah, I mean, they're not very plot heavy typically. It's a lot of small situations that sort of accumulate into a full story rather than like an ongoing plot for the most part. I mean, Local Hero probably has the strongest like plot through line, and he also did an adaptation of an 87 adaptation of Marilyn Robinson's novel Housekeeping, which was Forsyth's first American film. And if you've spent any time in the literary fiction circles, Housekeeping is like a sacred novel. Yeah. So he's always been someone who's had, you know, immense respect from critics, and his films have been fairly well received. I mean, they've all done pretty well they've all been low budget films. It's like the kind of filmmaking that's sort of disappeared almost, where you make a low budget film or a mid budget film and sell it to a specific audience, whether it's a teenage audience or just adults who want, you know, a nice thoughtful drama film. And you know, you may, word of mouth spreads and you make back your money and maybe get a few awards from it. That it's not totally dead, because I mean, look at something like Lady Bird, but it's definitely a sort of endangered species.
Yeah, definitely. Would you take a look at the cast of the film, because the cast is quite interesting in terms of their background. And we'll start with the main character, Gregory, played by John Gordon Sinclair. And basically, many of the young actors in this movie were members of what was called the Glasgow Youth Theatre. And a lot of them had appeared in one of Forsythe's earlier films, That Sinking Feeling. But John Gordon Sinclair, as a member of that group, you know, he became friends with one of the other cast members, Robert Buchanan. Both of them are fans of Rush.
So that's you had to bring that up.
Hey, man, I'm Canadian. Rush is like the Huey Lewis in the news of Canada. I'm just American kidding. I'm just kidding. Yes, Huey Lewis in the news, the number one American band of all time. Their equivalent is Rush. I will go on record with that. Anyway,
we've been wrong many times before, but that's maybe the wrongest we've ever been.
John Gordon Sinclair, he was in, of course, he appeared in Local Hero as well, and also 1989's Eric the Viking, which is the only other film that he's appeared in that I'm probably familiar with. Not going to mention the sequel to Gregory's Two Girls, which was not as successful. But John Gordon Sinclair here, Joel. Let's get your thoughts on him real quick, because in terms of my own thoughts, you know, the first thing that strikes me about him is his physical features. He's tall, he's gangly, he's awkward.
He's so gangly, I love it.
Yeah, I know, right? And it actually seems like he's a kid who just recently hit his growth spurt and just grew like 3 feet. And it's kind of sort of made him uncoordinated at football or soccer to us Americans now.
Oh, totally. I mean, I have to give credit to the Glasgow Youth Theatre, because these kids are all so real and natural. And it's like, I guess, you know, years of Nickelodeon, Disney Channel, especially Nickelodeon as it stands right now. I mean, a lot of those kids, especially Nickelodeon, come from theater, but they're all so polished. I mean, they're all so like, you know, even when they're talented, there's a sense that they've never been a real teenager, and if you've ever met theater kids, even the ones who aren't polished can kind of be like that, because they're so performative. They're always fucking on. it's exhausting. But these kids, like, you know, John Gordon Sinclair in this has so much energy, but it's not that theater kid energy. It's like a kid who has all this energy and has no direction, no idea what to do with it. Like, that's realistic. And of course, the fact that he's so gangly and he's clearly uncoordinated, he's not that good at football, and maybe he was, but now he's got a body that he doesn't really know how to operate. It's like he's behind the wheel of a car with, like, a stick shift that he doesn't know how to drive. But he's got all this, like, it's not manic energy. It's not grating in any way. It's just he's a kid with...
It's kid energy.
Yeah.
Yeah. And one of the early scenes... I mean, the very first scene, we got a group of kids standing outside. I believe she's a nurse. Just standing outside this nurse's window watching her undress. So they're getting a little bit of a peep show. It was funny because they left. They got what they came for and they left. And then the second group of kids comes along and watches for her. But one of the scenes after that shows Gregory waking up the next morning, and He's getting up and stretching. He's in front of his bedroom window. And I found this to be a little subtle, and it was kind of funny. He looks at his window for a second and then remembers to pull the shades down. So he's remembering the peep show from the night before. So kind of a little... this movie just have many moments like that, little funny, subtle humor. And spread throughout this movie. They kept it crisp and, very, it kept things moving along. You know, when the... there's not much of a plot to the film, really. It's just... here's Gregory, and here's his, awkward teenage experiences, and basically peppering humor throughout this really helped, you know, move things along, and I appreciate little subtle moments just like that one.
It's a great moment. What you said about the film being crisp, I think, is absolutely accurate, because this is a film that the only way you could tell this is from, like, 1980 is the... details of the technology around them, still using this could have been made this year because.
I want to interject for a second. Sorry, Joe, but I'll interject. But I did want to make note that the opening credits music did actually sound like an 80s sitcom.
That's fair. That's fair. I mean. Scotland has a history of great indie rock, but it wasn't quite there yet. I mean, it's still like 5 years before the Shop Assistants at this point. By the way, if you listen to as much like Camera Obscura as I have, you'll be ready for the accents in this. Like, if you're like the kind of panty waist who listens to Bell and Sebastian, you're already here, so don't worry. But this is... Like, I think the only thing that's aged probably is the peep show scene, and even then, it feels like this scene is not only, of course, there's the level of thought where Gregory has that reflection, like has that vulnerability and discomfort with his own body, because that's the kind of thing that you'd get some in a stupid teen movie, like a teen sex comedy, or even like a John Hughes level movie, you get a stupid dick joke. Like, so it is somewhere probably, like, and of course if it were a teen sex comedy, it'd be like this whole public humiliation thing back on the main character so we can feel good about the voyeurism. It's all balanced.
Yeah,
but here that seems to be a retort to that kind of like broad stupid humor, and I'm not sure how much of that was in existence in Britain. When I think of like British sex comedies, I think of like Benny Hill, like real like cheeky slapstick like that rather than Porky's. There's good natured naughtiness, but it's all pretty goofy. Like, it doesn't get as lascivious as like a Porky's or Meatballs or the teen sex comedies in America could, but I'm sure that at this point they were pretty well known in other English-speaking countries as well. I mean, you know, this is about a year removed from, like, The Last American Virgin, which was a remake of an Israeli teen sex comedy. So I think at this point was pretty well known because the teen audience in every country that had a going film concern was huge at this point. Yeah. So it does feel like a retort to that kind of filmmaking. I mean, because there are a lot of cringy, embarrassing moments, but they're not those big, like, here's a wacky, like, big public humiliation. They're moments like that where there's, like, a reflection or where he's just trying to talk to an obviously disinterested girl, and there's clearly a gap in how enthusiastic he is and how enthusiastic she is. Like, things that are embarrassing because you've been there.
Yeah. And so basically what we get in terms of story, of course, Gregory, we already talked about him being an awkward teenager. He's on his school's – we call it soccer. They call it football. We'll call it football for context. And
we'll be fine.
Yeah. His team sucks. And the coach is played by Jake Darcy. Coach Phil. Basically, he wants to put some new players on the team, so he holds a tryout for new players. And one of the one of the attendees of the tryout is a girl by the name of Dorothy, played by Dee Hepburn. And let's talk about Dee Hepburn for a minute here. I guess Gregory's Girl is probably the biggest film she's been in. She was on, she was in a British soap opera called Crossroads in the 80s. Not a whole lot in terms of career output for her. She did not come from the Glasgow Youth Theatre like most of the other cast in this movie. She was spotted by Bill Forsyth dancing in a TV commercial for a Scottish department store, the Scottish IKEA, I guess. Anyway, she other stuff she's been in. Well, other than TV and Gregory's Girl, she hasn't done a whole lot. She turned down the lead role of in Bolero.
She made the right choice.
Yeah, which eventually went to Bo Derek. She turned them down because of the required level of nudity and sexual content. So she had some dignity. And basically stuck to television roles for the most part. So not a huge career for Dee Hepburn, but here in Gregory's Girl, it's kind of a shame because we see a little inkling of a good actress here in Dee Hepburn. And her role opposite John Gordon Sinclair as Gregory, the character Gregory ends up falling in love with her at first sight when he sees how good she is at football, and basically she kind of gets the feeling that he likes her, but she's really not interested. But she likes him, and later on in the movie we see how she reacts to him asking her out on a date. We'll get to that. But what did she think, Joel? Dee Hepburn.
Oh well, I mean, first of all, it's a great instinct on Forsyth's part to like hire a dancer, like, because I mean she's like complete opposite of John Gordon Sinclair's Gregory. Like, she is so athletic and so graceful and so comfortable in her body, and obviously it probably helps that, like, because she's like the official hot girl at the school that all the boys are fascinated with, which is interesting because she's such a tomboyish character in like her actual actions and demeanor. But physically, I mean, she's filled out. There's this great moment where Gregory feels kind of slighted for her, like, failing to really get her attention. So in the mirror, he holds out his shirt like he's got big breasts. Like, he, like, just sort of spitefully to himself, like that kind of, and which is like just great encapsulation of like the reality of this, that like all the boys are fascinated with her, but also because there's such competition for her, because she's so self-assured, like there's that level of intimidation and even resentment towards her. I mean, that's, you know, I don't have the experience of being the hot girl in school, but I'm guessing that's probably what it's like, that sort of mix of intense idealization and resentment at the same time. Like, so in, and it's not like intent, like in a lot of other films guys would be would be doing crazy things to get noticed, but mostly it's just them trying, like, competing to even talk to her. And the amazing thing is that, like, she's not a character who gives a shit about any of that. She's so focused on athletics.
Yeah, and here the thing, I found it was kind of awkward, considering, you know, the era we're in now. I mean, she's on the team. And one thing we need to mention is that the coach brings her on, even though there are some misgivings about having a girl on the team. And she basically replaces Gregory, who's, I guess, demoted to goalkeeper. But the first game they play, she scores a goal. And what happens is all her teammates mob her and shower her with kisses. I mean, there are, like, kissing her, and Gregory's in goal, you know, getting angry at the situation, calling it disgusting because, of course, he's jealous that he's not out there. But it was kind of, I just felt kind of, I was kind of cringing a little bit at that scene just because of where we're at now. I was like, oh my gosh, it's like, it was kind of just uncomfortable to see all these guys gathering around one girl and just, you know, putting advances on her.
No, that's totally legit. I mean, it's a weird moment. I think even like for 1980, it's weird because like these are guys who, like, it's meant to be weird on a certain level because these guys are still trying to like decide with their like proto human brains what to think of her, because she's an emasculating presence, but at the same time she's like on a pedestal.
Yeah.
So like that moment is really that moment is really weird, and I'm sure like obviously it's weird for her too, because they like the only reason they don't hate her, even though she's showing them up, is because they get to like bask in her glory.
Yeah. And so as we move away from that scene a little bit, we'll go a little bit further. Now Gregory, of course, he's taking all sorts of measures to try and get her attention. There's one scene in the locker room where they're talking about speaking Italian, and next thing you know, he's going up to an Italian language teacher at his school, wanting to join the class, even though it's like mid-semester. And so he's trying to look for ways to get her attention, and he asks for help from his goofball assortment of friends as well, who are no help to him at all, because they're just as, if not more, awkward than he is. And of course, the one person that gives him some advice is his is his 10-year-old sister, Madeline, played by Allison Forster. He eventually gets up the nerve to ask Dorothy out on a date. And let's talk about the date, Joel. The date scene. Of course, Dorothy accepts, but when they show up at the meeting place, there's someone else there. And it's one of her friends named Carol. And she basically tells Gregory that something's come up and she can't make it. And he's, of course, let down, but he agrees to take her out for some chips, which are French fries. But this date was kind of like the, I guess we can call it the climax of the film, Joel, because a few things happen here that kind of turn the story around a little bit. Dorothy has arranged it with her friends to, I guess, trade off on him. I mean, he starts the date off expecting Dorothy, but he gets Carol. Carol hands him off to Margot, and then Margot hands him off to Susan, played by Clara Grogan. And this is where it kind of gets interesting.
Yeah, they pass him like along like a baton in a relay race. It's awesome. I mean, it might be maybe a little old fashioned, that idea that these girls are, even his sister, I want to bring that up in just a second, because I don't want to give short shrift to the film, and like I don't want to make our listeners who haven't seen it think it's like some 500 Days of Summer bullshit. Like his sister's clearly bright, and obviously the person he goes to, because the only indication we get of his relationship with his parents is that there isn't much of one. Yeah. He's a very sort of latchkey kid.
Yeah.
I mean, his sister is basically just giving him common sense advice that anyone who's not like a confused hormonal teenager would tell him. Like, she's obviously bright, but she's basically just saying, just ask her out already.
Yeah. You mentioned his parents, and there's one scene where, earlier in the film where we see him get up in the morning for school, and it seems like he's the only one around. He's got his electric toothbrush and he's making himself breakfast, and there doesn't seem to be anyone around. And then later on we see his father is like a driving school instructor, you know, they have a conversation through a car window. But, yeah, definitely a latchkey kid here. He doesn't have a whole lot of familial support. He probably gets more support from his friends than anything else. But we definitely get an inkling of his home life with that scene.
Yeah, oh, definitely. I mean, you know, there's just, he's got no guidance whatsoever. He's certainly not a dumb kid, blinded by his own hormones, obviously, like, you know, any kid his age. But, I mean, there's no support system. Like, his friends are sort of in the same position he is, and, you know, there's a sense that what separate, there is definitely a gender divide in this film, as I'm sure there still is among kids, even though it's probably lessening over time. But I think what makes it different is that these girls are a support system for each other, and these boys clearly, regardless of whether or not they're clueless, they're taught to be in constant competition.
Yeah.
Like, and... Sorry, go on.
No, go ahead. Finish your thought.
You know, I'm thinking about, like, how weird it is for them to have a girl on the team. And even now, like, I think I don't know what it's like in Scotland or the UK in general, but even now, like, sports in high school, they're gender divided. I mean, it's not impossible for a girl to be on the soccer team or actually a football team, an American football team, but...
Yeah.
You know, generally speaking, like, there's a boys' soccer team and a girls' soccer team. Boys' basketball, girls' basketball. There is, like, still that gender divide. I'm not saying that's good or bad. I'm just saying, like, you know, it's still enforced. And it's almost more, at least in America, that girls are habitually taught to be more like the boys, whereas here we've got a total separation. The girls have found their own route, which seems to be working much better.
Yeah, definitely. I tend to agree with that. You can, you know, we still keep sports separate. You know what I mean? We've got NCAA men's and women's, you know, sports and whatnot. And but, you know, back in 1980, at this time, of course, having a girl be on a boys' soccer team was going to, you know, create a stir. You know, within the context of the story itself, and we see that there is one later on as Coach Phil has a talk with one of the school officials about having a girl on the team. But yeah, it's one of those, subplots to Gregory's Girl here that gets addressed probably rather quickly because they don't spend a whole lot of time discussing the matter.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like, it's not a sports movie, it's not going to culminate in the big game or anything stupid like that. Like, it's just texture. Like, I mean, Coach Phil, first of all, I love him because he's so sad and lame and pathetic. It, like, he's like one of the teachers on Bob's Burgers.
Yeah.
He's a great character because him being so lame is so true to life. And, you know, he's fighting for this partly because, like, oh my god, we have a player who knows what the hell she's doing now.
Yeah, exactly. And so then we arrive pretty much, you know, we get back to the date scene where he ends up with Susan. And Susan tells him that this was all arranged by Dorothy, and she basically explains that, you know, it's just the way girls work, they help each other. And of course, we know that Gregory has some guy friends who are no help to him. So there's kind of a contrast in that short statement there, where you know, the girls are kind of looking out for each other, and the guys are really no help to each other at all.
Yeah, and you know, we get foreshadowing of this because, you know, we get Susan and Dorothy talking about Gregory, and like, it's clear, like, we see that Susan has an interest in him, and Dorothy just kind of... Dorothy's just been humoring him the entire time. She doesn't seem to dislike him, but she thinks he's kind of a goofy little joke, which he really is.
Yeah.
But she's also, like... I mean, it's clear, like, we understand why he would be fascinated by Dorothy, because she's so self-assured, but at the same time, she's clearly so wrong for him. She doesn't have much of a sense of humor, really. Like, and he's all humor. Yeah. Like, she's so driven and so focused, and he's the absolute opposite of that. This is not an opposites attract kind of story. They're just so wrong for each other. It's not even a matter of, like, she's out of his league or anything. They're just the wrong personality. He's just infatuated, which is totally legit. But when they actually, when he actually, you know, goes out on this sort of chain date and actually gets to talk to these girls, that, like, one by one, he really gets along with them better, until, like, finally we see him with Susan and they have such chemistry together.
Yeah. Yeah, and that was great. Another great thing about this whole thing is that Gregory's friends, he had a couple of friends, Andy, Charlie played by Graham Thompson, and Andy played by the aforementioned Robert Buchanan, and they see, at one point they see Gregory with three different girls, and they think that he's making out pretty good, and they get a little jealous of that, and so much to the point that they've heard that, and this was another funny scene in the movie where they heard that in Caracas, Venezuela, the women there greatly outnumber the men, so they want to hitchhike to Caracas, Venezuela, from Scotland, to try and get them some women. So that was kind of a funny moment in the film as well.
Yeah, it's funny on its own, and it's funny when you start to really consider their, like, perspective, because, like, clearly to them everything is quantity and probability. Like, the more women, the more chances I have. So they think Gregory's on three dates. This is incredible. He's living the life. And the whole point is that, like, the quality of they're missing the idea that the quality of connection and the quality of the date is what matters, because they just don't have the experience to see it.
Oh yeah. And yeah, like we mentioned, his friends, it's hard to imagine someone more awkward than Gregory, but yeah, he seems to be stable compared to these guys.
I mean, Gregory, like, has learning experiences over the course of this film. He like comes to understand what an actual quality conversation is, like what attraction really should be. Like, you know, we already get the sense that he understands, you know, pure loneliness. I mean, for him, I mean, so obviously there's a hormonal level, but, like, you know, you get the sense that maybe part of the interest in Dorothy, aside from the fact that she's, like, beautiful, is that she is so self-assured, and she's so, like, content with herself, and that's, like she's good at something he wants to be good at. Like, there's a sense that he almost, like, not only idolizes her in the putting her on a pedestal kind of way, but he wants to be that person that she represents. Like, he wants to be the male version of her. And there's just no way.
Yeah, not with that, those gangly legs that can hardly move.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Like, and, you know, that's the thing. Like, so much of this is, like, him trying to be... It's like sort of any kid, like, starts to develop into trying to be something you idolize, and then just gradually becoming comfortable with being yourself. I mean, that's the move from Dorothy to Susan. That's entirely what that is.
Yeah. Yeah. So, one other thing I want to mention is, you have to see this, to appreciate it. The person in the penguin costume.
Oh my god, yes!
Seen at different points in the movie for absolutely no reason. I mean, that was another little... I think another little subtle jab at attempt at humor there. And it's something that it kind of, like, takes us from one awkward funny scene to the next one, you know, at a few times there. And it's just... I love random stuff like that in movies, you know, just like, I guess it was a school mascot or something. I have no idea, but I mean, there was a person in a penguin costume and no one really seemed to make a big deal out of it.
It's a great little, like, weird transitional device. And yeah, my assumption too was school mascot, which is even funnier, because why would that is exactly the kind of doofy little, like, idea this lame little school, like mundane little school, would have for their mascot. I mean, there's absolutely no reason for some random Scottish high school to have a penguin mascot, but that, like, and you know, for me, it's like, I went to a high school in central New York, so our mascot was the Mohicans because central New York is like all native Iroquois territory. So many of the school mascots around here are Indian based. I mean, I know that's like, or native based. I know that's not PC anymore, which I totally get in terms of the Redskins, because holy shit, obviously.
Yeah.
But you know, for a school like mine that actually, you know, exists in an area with a long tribal history, and there's tribal lands nearby, like, I totally understand that, but, like, so for, like, there's a certain logic there, whereas, like, you know, there's tons of other schools with mascots that just seem chosen because no other local schools had them, and they sounded cool.
Yeah, I mean, there's no Loch Ness Monster mascot here, or
Highlander,
or a bowl of haggis or something. I don't know.
We don't know much about Scotland.
No, we don't. And judged on our choice of mascots, that would bear proof.
I know their music. I know, like, their indie twee pop. Like, that's, and I know. Bill Forsyth films. That's what I know about Scotland.
Yeah. Well, let's look at other aspects of this film, since we've discussed the plot at length. The British Film Institute placed it at number 30 on their top 100 British films. I mean, that's British films of all time, and there's some great films that come from the UK. To be placed, even to make the top 100 and to rank at number 30, UK holds this film in very high regard.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, the films it's above are pretty impressive. Life and Death of Colonel Blimp, Black Narcissus, Fish Called Wanda, Secrets and Lies. I mean, it's above, like, Brazil? It's above, like, tons of classic films, including, like, a lot of the... I mentioned the kitchen sink era of British drama. A lot of those are beneath this, which is really interesting. You'd think those might be a little more prized, because I'm sure a lot of the people voting on these films in 1999 were, you know, grew up with those films as their, like, big influences cinematically, but not the case.
Well, and Entertainment Weekly, that highbrow magazine, they had a top 50 high school movies, and this one, well, surprisingly made the list, considering it's Entertainment Weekly, and it's mainly an American audience looking at this. But it ranked at number 29 out of 50.
Should be higher. I'm sure number one was, like, you know, the Breakfast Club or something stupid like that.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm not going to look it up because I'll be sorely disappointed, I'm sure.
But mind you, speaking of Breakfast Club, like, you know, there are rumors that Criterion's going to do Gregory's Girl. I hope so, but they've got, like, Criterion did Breakfast Club, which...
They did Breakfast Club first? Oh.
It's got to be, like, someone on the Criterion team must have, like, some high school nostalgia for that crap.
The BAFTA, or the British Oscars, if you will. Awarded this film Best Screenplay, which is well deserved, but it was also nominated and didn't win for Best Film and Best Director. So some pretty high accolades for Bill Forsyth early in his career.
Absolutely. And what's interesting is that, like, it won for screenplay, where the screenplay here is not not particularly flashy.
Like, no, it's not, but I guess basically the subject matter and the treatment that it gave it, you know, the whole charm and I think it really got the whole teenage awkwardness thing right. So it was a pretty smart screenplay.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's a very smart screenplay, and it's very authentic, and I love that. I'm just really impressed, because those kind of awards usually go for, like, heavier-handed films, not so much for a subtle film like this is.
Yeah. We'll take a look at some of the critical responses to it. You know, we always like to quote, Roger Ebert is one of the more quotable critics out there, and of course he's probably the most renowned film critic in North America. So he gets quite a few quotes, and he basically said that Gregory's Girl is a charming, innocent, very funny little movie about the weird kid. Movie contains so much wisdom about being alive and teenage and vulnerable that maybe it would even be painful for a teenager to see it, just like we were talking about earlier, Joel. And maybe only grown-ups should see this movie, you know, people who have gotten over the pains of unrequited love. And then he offers a hollow laugh.
Poor Roger.
He awarded it 3 out of 4 stars, Joel. His high rating is 4 stars, so he liked it enough, I guess. There were some things he didn't. It wasn't really a negative review. He didn't really have anything negative to say about the film, but he didn't give it the full Monty. So I'm sure he took some issue with it. But
it's the kind of film where, like I said, I'm impressed at one best screenplay, because I absolutely do think it deserves accolades like that. But it's not the kind of. It's a film with a very gentle approach, and gentle films like that, like. I think so many critics, and I love film critics. I really have respect for what they do. But I think so many critics can get very jaded to things like that. Like, it takes a lot to impress someone who's seen thousands and thousands of movies. So when something comes on in a very sort of unassuming way, it's almost like. I almost feel like there's a little, like, even with Ebert, there's a little bit of defensiveness there. Like, they don't know how to take it.
Yeah. And overall, if you go to Rotten Tomatoes and search this film, you'll find that it got a 92%, only 13 reviews, but 92% is pretty dang good. So this is a well-regarded film, probably considered a classic in UK film history, and well worth seeking out. There was a sequel called Gregory's Two Girls, released in 1999, John Gordon Sinclair reprising his role of Gregory, who by then was 35 years old, got mixed reviews, never was released in North America or on DVD in North America, so there is a sequel to be sought out if you're so inclined. Just be forewarned that it's, of course, a step down from the original. Any other thoughts on Gregory's Girl, Joel?
Yeah, you know, I mean, it's looking through some of the critical responses. Variety mentioned that Forsythe's style recalls René Clair, which I think is really interesting, because I was also thinking like Jean Vigo with like Zero for Conduct, which is a bit more of a raucous film, but I think that essential like. Young energy that is sort of present in Gregory's Girl. It's not as wild an energy as something like Zero for Conduct sometimes has, but it's very, you know, it's got sort of a rakishness that I love, and it's also just this is going to sound like I'm damning with faint praise, but it's such a pleasant little film. I mean. And it is one where you're going to suffer some vicarious embarrassment, but you're going to be able to laugh at it, too. Yeah. And not a broad sort of slapstick, you know, fucking Porky's grab your crank through the hole in the wall laugh. But it's one where you're going to chuckle because you're going to remember how ridiculous you were, and you're going to take yourself less seriously, which is always a good thing. And I think maybe that's why, even though critics have, you know, roundly liked this film, why someone like Ebert could get, where I'd give this, like, you know, maybe like some people would consider it ridiculous to give a film that's not doing anything like really innovative 4 stars, but I think like that kind of authenticity and honesty is innovative to me because it's so lacking in a lot of films.
Yeah.
So like, you know, critics are predisposed to take themselves seriously because you have to if you're going to be an arbiter of taste, and it's a reminder that we're all sort of ridiculous, and that hurts sometimes, but God, you need it sometimes.
Yeah, it's 91 minute running time. It's a breeze of a movie, really. Once it's over, it'll feel like it had just started, really. I guess my thoughts on it, comedy's gentle spirited, written with humor and sympathy for the awkwardness of adolescence, and it's just a delightful movie. Also it kind of became like an international hit due to word of mouth at the time, because it's, you know, it is a small film. It was made for 200,000 British pounds, and of course the box office had made 25 million pounds. And so it was
now you just sound like Dr. Evil.
That was my really horrible British accent. And
I'm not going to try it because mine's going to be even worse. And I'd like to still
test it. I think I'll end up sounding too much like Ringo Starr or something. I don't know. Anyway, so yeah. Gregory's Girl. Good movie. And any other final thoughts on it, Joel? Because I have a feeling that we're about to wrap it up here.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, it's a film where, like, we can talk about it and it's fun to talk about, but it's a film that's just even more fun to experience. I mean, like, if I could live inside this film and be an awkward Scottish teenager and hang out with cute girls in berets, like, that's kind of my dream. Just put the Shop Assistants on the soundtrack and that's, like, my entire psyche.
Your entire psyche. I have a feeling that we're just scratching the surface with that.
I doubt there's much there.
All right, so that wraps up the first half of the show on our coming-of-age theme, Gregory's Girl. Very fine film. Seek it out. And if you can get through the thick accents, you're doing all right. But when we come back on the other side, we are going to shift spectrums. We're going to stick with the coming-of-age theme, but this is a totally different film. We're going to talk Boys in the Hood when we come back.
The perfect double feature.
The perfect double feature indeed. We'll be right back.
I know what boys like. I know what guys want.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Hey, pro wrestling announcer Kevin Kelly here. I want to make sure you are all subscribed to all the great feeds here at Place to Be Nation. It's really easy to do. Just head to iTunes or your preferred podcatcher app today and search and subscribe to the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, which, of course, includes the full archives of the Kevin Kelly Show, the Place to Be Nation pod feed, and the Pro Wrestling Only feed. Subscribe, listen, and then rate us and leave feedback today. And be sure to give Justin your true thoughts. I mean, don't hold back. After all, he is kind of a jerk. Just listen to Scott.
Place to Be Nation's JT Rizzero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have a ton of great podcasts available to you on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlayStation.com, and we offer those to you on three great feeds. On the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, we bring you the Mothership, the original Place to Be podcast, as well as Main Event, Lucha Afterground, and our monthly pay-per-view reaction shows, as well as the Our Vantage Point podcast and Jeff Learns Wrestling. In addition to these full-length shows, we also deliver quick-hit pod blasts on topics old and new.
Over on the Pro Wrestling Only feed, we dive deep inside the wrestling business with a stacked army of experts leading the way. The feed features potpourri shows such as This Week in Wrestling, Greetings from Allentown, Psychology is Dead, Puro Potpourri, Stacy and Elliot's Bogus Journey, and the Military Industrial Suplex. We also have shows that focus intently on certain topics like Letters from Center Stage, Space City, an NWA Classics On Demand adventure, Through the Years, Strong Style History, Strong Style Story, and Mount Olympus. Plus, the feed has the full archives of legendary shows like Titans of Wrestling, Where the Big Boys Play, Letters from Kayfabe, and much more. And on our popular Place to Be Nation Pop podcast feed, we offer such great shows as the Glenn Butler Podcast Hour Spectacular, Rank and File, PTBN Dadcast, Go Home in a Box, NBA Team, and Lucha Undead, as well as a veritable podcast heaven for comics fans with the Hard Traveling Fanboys, Sellers Points, Todd Weber's Conversation, Geek and Sassy, and Imaginary Stories podcasts.
You can find all of these current shows plus archives of our past podcasts, including The Kevin Kelly Show, as well by subscribing to all of our feeds on iTunes, and while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback as well. All of these shows, plus others, available on PlacementNation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects and more. Be sure to support our site by using PlacementNation.com/Amazon when shopping online, and download our free PTB Vintage Vault Refresh eBooks via the links on our site. We also want to thank our friends at Bonehead's Wing Bar in West Warwick, Rhode Island, in Fall River, Massachusetts, TheHistoryOfWrestling.com, and Scott Keith's Blog of Doom. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlacementNation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Man, don't you know this is a dead body?
Yeah, motherfuckers, I know that shit. He ain't bothering you, so don't fuck with him. Yo, throw the ball, little man. I ain't going to take it. Little Chris, tell this fool I ain't going to take his ball. I got enough money to buy me 100 balls. Shit.
Man, I told you not to bring that ball.
Several boyhood friends come of age against the backdrop of South Central Los Angeles in 1991's Boys in the Hood, directed by John Singleton. His debut. 22 years old at the time, Joel. That's just insane.
Oh my god, that's insane. I'm not sure I could, like, use a phone at 22.
Here, keeping with our coming-of-age theme, inspired by Lady Bird, which is awkward to say. but
they really connect, obviously.
Yeah, this really is a coming-of-age film. I think the best parts of this movie start off. The whole movie's fine. This is like a national treasure. This film, but the beginning, the early scenes that take place in 1984, when the lads are just even we lads at this point came up with some of the more interesting and memorable scenes. We've got a group of several different friends here. We've got Trey Styles. That's a cool name, man. Trey Styles. He's played by Desi Arnaz Hines II at age 10. The older version is Cuba Gooding Jr. And we've got Darren Doughboy Baker, played by Baja Jackson as a 10-year-old. He'll be Ice Cube when he becomes older. His brother, half-brother, I believe, Ricky Baker, played by young Donovan McCrary at the age of 10. Morris Chestnut is the grown-up version. And these are the three main characters at this point. So the movie opens up in 1984, and Trey lives with his single mom, Reva, who's played by Angela Bassett, who always provides fine work in whatever film she's in. Trey gets into a fight at school. His teacher tells his mom that Trey is pretty smart, but he lacks respect and has a temper. So she sends him to live in Crenshaw, in South Central LA, with his father, played by Lawrence Fishburne, who has an even cooler name than Trey, Furious Styles. I love the names of these guys. So he goes to live with his dad, Furious. His mom hopes that Trey will learn some valuable life lessons and mature and basically, he'll be allowed to return to her one day. He's kind of upset that he has to leave his mom, but he'll learn to be a man and return to her, is what she's hoping. So when he's in Crenshaw, he reunites with his old friends, Doughboy and his brother Ricky. And they have a friend named Chris. Chris is played by Kenneth A. Brown as a 10-year-old, but Reg Green, as he gets older, that character would end up in the future becoming crippled by some gunshot wounds and be confined to a wheelchair. It's an interesting character aspect there. Furious puts Trey to work right away, you know, trying to teach him some maturity, has him rake the leaves in his front yard. Basically, Furious tells Trey that he has him work to teach him how to be responsible. But, later that night, Trey hears his father shooting at a burglar who's trying to rob the house. And we get two cops arrive like an hour later. I mean, Furious is, up waiting for him. He's kind of pissed off that it took so long for them to show up. It's kind of funny because the white cop is kind of, he plays the good cop. He's kind of civil and courteous here. But it's the black cop that is kind of disrespectful towards Furious. And we kind of see that later on in the film as well. Let me ask you, let's stop here for a second, Joel, and ask you about this aspect of it. We've got some might consider it a role reversal here with these cops.
Oh, definitely. I mean, that's one of the things that sets this apart from other similar films in the 90s. I mean, first of all, most other films with a South Central LA or other inner city setting and like gang motifs or gang plots would not have the characters as kids. And, it's almost easy to forget when we see them later on that they're only 17 but that element that there is like a self-hating element in a lot of black people, even people who are from these, fucking oppressed, like economically just bleak areas, that there's an element of separation from black identity that, like, this guy, he's a cop more than anything. He's almost like a bit over the top when we see in later scenes when we see him where he's like Charles Bronson. It's almost like he has no recognition of any similarity between himself and the people he's policing, even though if he's in this area, there's a good chance he even came from this area.
Yeah.
Like, there's an, he refers to people, he refers to, like, of course he's using the N-word, by the way, obviously.
Yeah.
This is a film where, that flies all the time, but, he's almost, he's, like, referring to all these, like, citizens of this neighborhood as, like, thugs and scumbags. He's talking like a vigilante in an 80s canon film.
Yeah, so I mean that was an interesting aspect to introduce in this movie, kind of like a bit of a role reversal there. Yeah, and you mentioned the self-hatred there, very interesting. So, but we get to another interesting aspect of the early part of the story as we kind of go Stand By Me-ish here, where the kids one of the kids knows where they can find a dead body, and they go set out to go check out, of course, and Stand By Me. The kids go on like a 2-day trek through the woods to find the dead body. But here in Crenshaw, you just have to go around the corner.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great, like, fascinating use of, like, pre-established cinematic language. I mean, the idea of the coming of age story where you see some, where you venture to see something that's beyond childhood understanding. Like, they live among things that are supposed to be beyond childhood understanding. Like, the way you it totally changes the way you define childhood and adulthood, and like how you're, like, this is a film full of people trying to figure out what it means to be a grown man. In particular, like, you know, Lawrence Fishburne Furious is trying to teach Trey what it means to be a man. Like, the characters around Trey are trying to, like, their fathers at young ages, they're in gangs, they've been in prison, and they've gotten out. Like, they're all trying to figure out what it means to navigate adulthood, and they're still not even legal age to, like, vote or smoke cigarettes.
Right.
And certainly not legal age to drink. I mean, obviously they're drinking, like, nonstop in this film, but like you know, childhood doesn't totally exist. Like, if it does, it's because you have to almost physically carve out a separate space for it. Like, and yeah, part of what Furious is doing when Trey's a kid is doing that, but at the same time teaching him to be using that safer space to teach him to be an adult in the right way, rather than having him encounter things no child should.
Right, yeah. And what we've got, still kind of sticking with the similarities to Stand By Me, is we've got, much like in Stand By Me, we've got a group of older boys who were, I guess they're members of the Crips, and they steal Ricky's football. And, of course, Doughboy tries to get it, but they beat him down, and you know, I guess there's kind of like a respect thing going on there, because, you know, I guess Ricky stood up to them, and, one of the gang members, gives them the football back before they walk away with it. So, kind of like reminiscent of Stand By Me with Kiefer Sutherland and his gang of cronies. So, there's that element in it as well. But of course, and then we get the father-son bonding moment with Furious and Trey later on when they go fishing, and he tells him about Vietnam, and he wants his son to be proud of him, and he tells Trey never join the army, telling him that a black man has no place in the army. So there's a little bit of anger in Furious as well. He's an intelligent man, and here's a man who's risen above the streets, so to speak, but he's still angry about it, and so that's a little prevalent throughout the movie. And of course, yeah, go ahead.
Oh yeah, I was gonna say Furious, I mean, he is definitely prone to a bit of speechifying, which fits within the story because he's actively trying to teach his son. But yeah, I mean, there's so many interesting placements of characters, like, in terms of economics, in terms of culture, where Furious is still angry about what he's been through, but he's incredibly well-read, and he's like so socially aware, and he's still trying to be part of this community, even though, like, other people nearby think he's a bit, you know, high and mighty, he's too good for them. He's still trying to achieve a sort of black community independence, where and you get this, of course, his ex-wife Reva, Angela Bassett, like, she's trying to mainstream, basically. Like, I forget what she's, when we see her when Trey is a kid, she's going to is. She's going to school. She's like doing her graduate work. I forget if they said what she's going to be, but it's clear she's like, whether it's like a professor or a lawyer, she's always she's always well dressed in a very like traditionally professional manner. So like, she's someone who, you know, not that I have firsthand experience, but I know that's sort of a long-term argument within Black culture. I mean, African American culture specifically. Like, do you try to mainstream and move somewhere else, move to a better place, move to the suburbs, like try and make your way independently? Do you try to lift up your own neighborhood? Do you take that burden on yourself? I mean, as parents, they're like, you get the sense that they sort of strongly embody these ideals, that this was part of what destroyed their marriage. Even aside from the fact that, you know, they had a child incredibly young and he went to Vietnam. Like, obviously, it's done a lot of soul searching since. Like, there's major philosophical differences between them on what the Black experience is, parenthood is.
Right, yeah. And exactly. And so we get kind of, the two, I guess, and like you said, it probably led to the downfall of their marriage, but two kind of like opposing views. One from Furious, where, you know, you bring your neighborhood up by, improving yourself and trying to have that reflected in your neighborhood. And then there's the other viewpoint where I'm just moving out of here and, you know, making out on my own.
I should mention that Furious, like, has a job. He helps people get home ownership loans.
Yeah,
I mean,
he's a mortgage broker. Yeah.
Yeah, he gives a speech about gentrification, which in 1991, I'm sure, honestly, that idea was probably new to a lot of audiences. I mean, now we talk about it all the time because, you know, especially, you know, me living in New York State, having lived in New York City, I mean, you hear that all the time in regards to, say, Brooklyn, which is not, especially about a decade ago, where it was first becoming that trust fund hipster haven. But, like... But yeah, like that's a constant idea here, and he's like, Furious is, he's almost a bit of a wish fulfillment character because he's just like ceaselessly wise. I mean, I'm glad we get scenes of him and Angela Bassett because she kind of puts him in his place, saying you didn't do anything mothers haven't been doing since the beginning of humanity. Like, yeah, I mean, this is the guy who's trying to take on this, like, project of saving South Central L.A. entirely on his own.
Yeah, exactly. And, of course, when Furious and Trey return from their little fishing trip, the cops are in the neighborhood, and they've taken in Doughboy and Chris. And the 1984 segment ends with Doughboy and Chris in the back of a police car getting arrested for shoplifting. They're 10 years old.
Yeah, and they're being, of course, they're being dragged away in, like, handcuffs. They're 10-year-old kids, what are they going to do? But I'm sure that's more than common to see.
Yeah. Like, and so, and that kind of sets the tone for a couple of those characters there. So, at that point, we flash forward to current day, 1991. Of course, it opens with a big house party for Doughboy getting out of jail. He's now a member of the Crips. And of course, Ricky, his brother, is a big football star in high school, and he's being courted for scholarships, football scholarships. The mom, Brenda, who plays Brenda? Oh, Tyra Farrell. It's obvious that she favors Ricky because of the bright future that he has, and she's obviously given up hope on Doughboy developing into anything, even though he's still only 17 years old at this point.
To break in just a bit, like, that's a really interesting element to me because it's really hard to figure out what came first, her favoring one son who does have a bright future, or like, did the favor come first, or were there natural inclinations, or, you know, not necessarily natural, but just like socially imposed inclinations, did those come first? I mean, obviously, as a kid, like, you know, Doughboy is a bit delinquent. He's got a temper. He shoplifts, and you know, Ricky is much more passive. He's, you know, a quieter kid. He's just focused on football. He doesn't go anywhere without his football. Like, but I mean, if she had shown Doughboy like the same amount of support, like, we get indications that in jail he's done a lot of reading, like,
yeah,
I mean, this is actually fairly common in like Black coming of age stories. There's a, like, the sensitive kid who's on the right track, and the angrier one who's not. I mean, it's in, you know, it's in Cooley High, it's in the learning tree. Like, it's a pretty common element, and here I think it's to the extent where maybe it's a bit cliche, but here I think it's done well, because there's indications maybe that Doughboy could have been Trey had he had someone like Furious around.
Yeah, and that's a good point, you know. But of course, at this point in the film, Mom Brenda thinks Doughboy is hopeless, and she's given up on him. You can see a very contentious relationship there. Ricky, the potential football star, he's got a girlfriend and a kid. He's 17 years old, so I mean, a lot of responsibility is starting to come upon this guy. Trey has grown up into a somewhat mature, responsible kid. He works at a clothes shop in the mall and wants to go to college with his girlfriend. There's a whole relationship there between him and his girlfriend, played by Nia Long. Ricky's going after a scholarship from USC. That scene with a recruiter, obviously out of his element, coming into this neighborhood. Embarrassing Doughboy. The house is a mess. Doughboy is rude.
Well, and that's the thing. Doughboy is like, you know, brash, but he's also the one who, like, is clearly like, everyone, shut up. He's here for my brother. Take this seriously.
Yeah, and that's the thing we learn about Doughboy, and I think a lot of that goes into Ice Cube as well, because Doughboy is, he's not, like, overall, he's not a bad person. He wants his brother, he wants his friends to get out of the situation that they're in. I mean, he's supportive of them. He wants them to do well. Probably sounds like he's, much like his mom, he's given up hope on himself ever becoming anything as well.
It does seem to be the case. I mean, he's got a lot of built-up resentment towards his mom, towards his brother, but he's still trying to do the right thing for his brother. I mean, he's an interestingly complicated character, because so much of what, like, there's a repeated motif where a lot of these guys just don't have any way of expressing what they feel. And actually, he's a bit, despite, like, there's this amazing moment, we'll get more into like some of the gender stuff in this movie,
yeah,
but where he's talking about the idea in prison, a book he was reading where because he's an atheist, he doesn't believe that like any world where kids are dying on the street is a world where there's a God existent. And he mentions that if God was a woman, like, there wouldn't be nuclear warfare. There wouldn't be anything. It's not in woman's nature. But of course, he phrases it as if God was a bitch. So that like divide between like that sort of cultural influence, like, he's where the girl he's with is always pointing out why you always calling women bitches or hoes or hoochies, and he says because that's what you are. And but at the same time, he's eloquently talking about the idea that a female yeah. deity would not allow such a violent world. I mean, there's that really fascinating divide in him where he's eloquent at the same time not.
Well, yeah, and his character, Ice Cube's character, Doughboy, really gets some of the best lines in the movie in terms of humor.
I mean, the first time we see him, he's like, Domino, motherfucker.
Yeah, and I think there's a scene from, like, back in the 1984 setting where one of the kids has a comic book collection. He says, this kid's got more comic books than a motherfucker.
He's awesome. Yeah, it's, and that's what I was where he... He's in that same scene with... where he's in the car talking after this confrontation, which we'll get into it, but yeah. He's just complaining about people always trying to show how hard they are, and I think Chris says, you're doing that all the time too, and he laughs and high fives him because it's true, and he can't even deny that. That divide is constant, and it's not just in him either. I mean, like, there are times where, like, Trey, who's the sensitive, most eloquent one, he's so full of pent-up anger and frustration, he can't really properly express it verbally. It's just overtaking it, and it's almost frightening because we've seen this character who responds to things pretty tactfully and gracefully,
yeah,
like, it just fall apart. It's just heartbreaking.
Yeah. And of course we get back to a little bit of the story here where they show the kids taking the SATs. And the SATs are important for Ricky to get his football scholarship, of course. And so after they're done taking the SATs, they go to see Furious. And they just want to, chillax, and kick back a little bit and hang out with Trey's cool dad. And what does he want to do? He wants to take them out and talk about the dangers of... the decreasing property values in the black community. So fun times.
They want to relax after, like, the biggest test of their life, and he wants to lecture them about gentrification. It's that, like, clash of elements of this that works really well, because, like with the Stand By Me thing, elements like taking the SATs, taking the big test, that's such a trope of all high school stories. And here we've got that trope, but at the same time, it's characters who are, like, surrounded by gangs or surrounded by shootings constantly. We see Neil Long's character, Brandy, Trey's girlfriend. We see her frustrated because she's trying to do homework, and she can't concentrate because there's so much gunfire around. There's, like, this constant motif of, like, spotlights and helicopter blades whirring because, like, the cops are always flying overhead.
Yeah, it's almost like the neighborhood's like a prison, and the spotlight is always on them.
It very much is. I mean, everything, and not to get too highfalutin, but, like, everything you've ever read about, by Foucault or whoever, about, like, the psychology of prison, of always being watched, always being under examination, that's always in play here. You're always having to answer for who you are and who everyone else is.
Yeah.
Like, it's just absolutely constant. And, like, here's the part that blows my mind. Like, I kept thinking about that, and Escape from New York, and that's supposed to be a sci-fi
thing. Yeah, exactly. That's a good point. It's a lot like that. Yeah, cool. So then, of course, one of the more important scenes in the movie at this point comes when all the local kids are hanging out at a street race, and Ricky runs afoul of a gangster. Ferris, what do they call him? The Crenshaw Mafia, yeah. But Doughboy, of course, sticks up for Ricky by showing him his gun, and there's a little scuffle, and then Ferris chases everyone out by shooting his gun in the air, and of course that's going to come into play later on, this whole confrontation. Yeah, I mean, what are your thoughts on that scene, Joel?
Oh, I mean, it's a great scene because it escalates so quickly, but at the same time, like, yeah, I feel like so many films of this stripe, like, really use the gangster element in a really exploitative fashion, but here it's just, like, another texture. Like, all it takes is, like, one moment, like, the classic, like, I'm walking by, here's a guy who thinks he's a big man, I'm gonna bump into him, and, like, you know, totally disrespect him.
Yeah.
Like, just that one thing leads to so much... that one stupid thing escalates so quickly and leads to so much tragedy. And also, I find it also instructive that, like, here's another element where, like, the women are the ones in this situation, like, that are stuck diffusing it. Like, it's Ferris's, like, girlfriend or just, you know, girl that's running with his crew who's like, can't we have one night where you're not fighting or shooting each other?
Yeah.
Of course, Doughboy brandishes his piece, which is just, like, a handgun. And there's, like, a literal arms race escalation because Ferris fires a goddamn Uzi into the air disperse everyone. Like, that... Like, that's... It's a literal arms race going on, and it's all just, you know, that sort of, like, stupid escalation of everything, which is, of course, this is the part where we get Ice Cube talking about, like, everyone having to show how hard they are, and, yeah, having to admit that he does the same thing, because that's what he did. I mean, yeah, there, obviously, this is a total, like, cauldron. I mean, it's just pent up anger and energy. I mean, you know, it's funny that that on a surface level that we're teaming this with Gregory's Girl, but at the same time, like, these are all young male characters who have more energy than they know what to do with and no direction. So, and some of it, like, Ricky, Trey, they've got, like, direction, but Ricky is a sort of, tenuous. I mean, he's got to get the grades to get into the school. He's got, and then, you know, there's no guarantee that he's going to make a career out of it. He'll get him to college, but he's still not entirely sure what he wants to do. We get this amazing scene where he's watching an army commercial.
Yeah.
And he's thinking, and later he talks to Trey about the idea, and Trey says, like, repeats the wisdom his father gave him, but uh-huh. Ricky's in the same boat like Furious was. He's a young man with a kid who wants to provide for his family and doesn't know what to do.
Yeah, exactly. All good points there. You know, and this, of course, brings us to another good scene where Trey and Ricky are leaving the scene of the shooting, and they're getting pulled over by the cops. And who's the cop that happens to pull them over, Joel?
It's the cop from the beginning who, like, yeah. And I forgot to mention when we were talking about that, the black cop, he was trying, like, after being a dick to Furious, he's trying to ingratiate himself with, like, 10-year-old Trey, like, hey, what's up, little man?
Yeah.
And Trey already knows at this age, because 10 is, like, might as well be an adult, uh-huh. like, where he lives, like, I'm gonna step back and hide behind my dad and not engage with this cop.
In this scene, the cop is 10 times fucking worse than he was earlier in the film. I think he's become even more self-loathing than he was earlier in the film, because now he's just messing with Trey and he's pulling out his gun on him and threatening him with it. And this is some scary bullshit for Trey.
Oh, it's a hard scene to watch because he's pointing out, like, oh, you know, I could blow your brains out right here. No one could do a thing about it. Like, first of all, that's fucking frightening. And yeah, it does, like, it shouldn't matter, but it does, like, increase the impact that this is a black cop telling him that, acting in the ways that, you know, we've been conditioned to understand, like, white cops do with, like, black citizens, even if they're not criminals, even if they're not, like, they just get pulled over, presumably because, you know, the cops were in the area after the gunfire. Like, they don't find anything on them. They're not part, like, they live in this area, but they're not part of the Crips. They don't carry around drugs. They haven't been drinking. Like, literally, we see, like, Ricky and Trey earlier, like, before the gunfire, like, you know, walking around with bags of chips. Like,
yeah.
Like, just tailgating like normal people.
Yeah, and so it's not long after this scene, of course, that turning point of the film, the climax, so to speak, with Ricky and Trey just doing something simple as walking to the store, going to get food for Ricky's baby. They run into Ferris and his gang, and definitely is the biggest emotional, impactful scene in the film, as Ricky gets shot in the back, and of course Doughboy and his gang are too late. I think they kind of had the idea that something was up, and they went to go after Trey and Ricky, but they're too late, and they bring Ricky back to the house, and all hell breaks loose as everybody is upset, and Mom blames Doughboy, and you know, kicks him out of the house, and this is where Doughboy plots his revenge on Ferris and the gang, and Trey, of course, is in the middle of this, and he feels the same. And, Doughboy vows revenge on Ferris, and we get Trey going home to get his dad's 357 Magnum, and Furious finds him, and, of course, Furious trying to convince Trey to, be a man about the whole thing. This is just one of those scenes. You really have to see it to appreciate it. I mean, we could talk about it, but just all the emotion on screen at this point is just this is what really, I think, in my mind, makes the film pretty memorable.
Oh yeah, I mean, there's so much going on, and even these are big scenes, but there's like small little touches that like increase the authenticity. Like when they bring Ricky's body home, and you know, their mom is crying over it, and Ricky's girlfriend is crying over it, and she's got their son in her arms, and
yeah.
Doughboy's trying to take the kid away, like, he doesn't need to see this, but they're so distraught that they're pushing Doughboy away, and they're, of course, their mom, Brenda, is blaming Doughboy, thinking it was his fault that Ricky got shot because of the way he lives, but, like, straight up, it could have happened to anybody, because it was just that, you know, all that kind of anger and there's just that ongoing escalation. Like, I don't know how to express myself, so I'm going to like mess with someone else. And we get that throughout the film, because it starts with them just like, you know, sort of driving. Starts with like the Crenshaw Mafia sort of driving by, like in an aggressive, like threatening way. Like, you know, there's an earlier part where like Trey like is walking across the street, and they nearly run him over, and then they like brandish the shotgun out the window just to mess with him.
Yeah,
like there's that constant like one-upsmanship and like establishment of dominance, just like, you know, everyone's is looking for some way to be in control. I mean, one of the things I want to talk about just briefly is like after Trey gets threatened by that cop, he goes to his girlfriend's house, and he's so frustrated that he breaks down, and he's like just punching the air, and she's scared, and he basically collapses into her arms, and it turns into the first time they have sex, which has been an ongoing thing in this film.
Yeah,
like he's a virgin, he feels embarrassed by it, because you know it's not masculine. He even like tells a fake story to his dad about getting laid the first time, but being run off by this obviously fake girl's grandmother.
Yeah.
Like even in his like pet house fantasy story, like it doesn't like end up well for him. Like you know, their relationship has been, you know, hit or miss, because he's trying to pressure her into having sex, but she wants to wait till marriage. She's Catholic, like, she goes to Catholic school, like there's that element of trying to establish your masculinity in every possible way, either through violence, through sex, I mean, through using woman, like, that's a constant thing. Like, you know, when Trey tells the fake story about these girls riding up to the corner where all these dudes are hanging out, and like he gets with the really hot one that he made up, like all the guys are like running, like they're, it's like the scene in Gregory's Girl with the surrounding her, like all the guys are like running up, like, you know, thirsty dogs. But
yeah,
but it sounds, it's just like, it sounds less like trying to have a conversation with someone than trying to like overwhelm them with military force.
Right. Yeah. Like,
and the kind of weird thing about Ricky's, like, about Trey's fake story is that this girl approaches him, which is, there's that like push pull between like masculinity and not, because she's the one in the masculine role, like running game. But it's also a sign that like, he's the real man here, because he didn't have to do anything to grab her attention.
Yeah. And we see a real character turning point for Trey after Ricky's been shot, and he wants to, his first instinct is to go grab his dad's gun. Of course, his dad talks him out of taking the gun, but Trey sneaks out of the house anyway and ends up in the car with Doughboy and the gang. But, you know, Trey has a change of heart. He realizes that, you know, his dad was right, and he has to be let out of the car. And, you know, they let him out. And, of course, later, not long after that, Doughboy and company get revenge in the most violent manner. But it's the next day. Interesting, Doughboy comes over to see Trey. And he basically tells Trey that he did the right thing by getting out of the car. You know, Doughboy knows what he's done and the repercussions that are to come. And he doesn't want to see Trey fall victim to that. And I really think that Doughboy, I think, is the MVP of this whole, the character. You know, Ice Cube, in general. You know, he's the MVP of this whole movie for me, because the character... there's actually a lot of depth to his character, you know. He's a gang member, and but at the same time, he's living vicariously through his friends and his brother. He wants them to do good things and get out of the situation that he finds himself in. So this is really, really good, really strong acting and screenwriting here. On this part.
And yeah, it's all really well done. And Doughboy's in such an interesting place, because like you never stop feeling like he's part of this gang, because this is his support system. This is literally all he has, even though he's like clearly like the one in charge. He's like the parental one, and we see elements of him being like being more like, honestly, a lot like Furious in some ways. He's just hasn't had the chance to actually really think through what his life is, or if he has, or just feels totally resigned to it, I guess.
Yeah.
He's just in a really interesting and sad place, where it's almost taken for granted that Trey and Ricky, you know, before Ricky gets shot, of course, have a future. No one's ever thought that about him. And there's something weirdly poignant about the fact that now he's not fat anymore. He's like he's really buff, because he's, you know, not, like he says, there's nothing to do in the pen but lift weights. he's strong and he's masculine, but it's easy to forget he's 17, but he's still called Doughboy.
Yeah. Yeah. And of course, the bittersweetness end to this was the fact that the mom, Brenda, Ricky and Doughboy's mom, Brenda got Ricky's SAT scores and saw that he passed his SATs and he would have gotten the scholarship that he was seeking with USC. So kind of like a harsh reminder of things in that one few minutes scene there.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's moments like that. I mean, they're definitely effective, but there's a level at which almost like it's so earnest that if anything about this film is aged, it's that, because we just don't make films that are that baldly like earnest to have those like big ironies.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, it does. Like, I wouldn't say this is on the level of an After School Special at all, because it's just much more authentic. It's much better written, much better acted. Like, but you know, elements like that, where because this is Singleton's first film, he's sort of, there's times where he's relying on other, on pre-existing cinematic or you know television language, and in both his direction and script. So moments like that, even though they're really effective because you've got so many different elements here that it doesn't feel like a trope, like there is an element where it's so earnest and so wants to impart like these ideas to you. Like, I mean, this is obviously the work of a young, raw, but incredibly talented filmmaker and writer who just has so much to say that he doesn't know where to start.
Yeah. And I think that's a good point there. So go ahead and finish with that.
Yeah, I mean, just like sometimes the way the camera moves, it's like he doesn't even know what to look at first. Like in the really heavy dramatic scene, it seems like it's moving around, not in a really like nauseating way, like a lot of action films. Like the action scenes are shot now, just like there's so much chaos. He's trying to capture all of it. It's just. So, you know, that sort of raw but not entirely focused level of, like, talent. Yeah, I mean, it definitely is the work of a first filmmaker, but it's the work of a first-time filmmaker who has so much going on in his work. I mean, Gregory's Girl was, like, an earlier film from Bill Forsyth, but, you know, having spent years with documentary footage, like he's content to be quieter and let like scenes play out a bit more languidly, or let like you know the locations speak for themselves. I mean, here's a case where like Singleton's good at letting these locations speak to because they're fully inhabited. I mean, this is all being filmed in South Central LA, but this is such a passion project for him because he'd been working on it for like the better part of a decade by this point. I mean, he met Lawrence Fishburne while working on Pee-wee's Playhouse as a stagehand, and
yeah,
actually had Lawrence Fishburne and Paul Rubens look at his early scripts for this, which I would have loved, like Paul Rubens' reaction to the early drafts of Boys in the Hood. Like, but yeah, that's how he gets. But I mean, this is a young film student who like gets to make his passion project with a guy he had like been trying to court for years into this. I mean, it's a film where there's so much going on screen that you almost don't know where to look sometimes. And part of that is we've got a great cast. We're all like honest to God movie stars in this.
Yeah. And we want to talk about John Singleton there real quick. Of course, Boys in the Hood was his debut and it was nominated. He got a nomination for Best Director, an Academy Award nomination for Best Director. He didn't win. Some other films, and of course he was nominated at the age of 24, and at the time he was the youngest director ever nominated, and he was the first African-American director to get a nomination, so he was kind of a trailblazer. Well, I wouldn't say a trailblazer. I mean, he had Spike Lee before him, but Spike Lee never really got the respect that that he deserved from the Academy, unfortunately for Spike.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Do the Right Thing was a major film, but, I mean, even that was a mixed-race cast. I mean, that definitely led to Boyz N the Hood, but this is definitely like a benchmark moment for like African American cinema.
It is. Singleton, of course, would follow up with films like Poetic Justice in 1993, Higher Learning in 1995, and then the excellent Rosewood in 1997. But then he's also done some action films like the remake of Shaft, starring Samuel L. Jackson. He did the sequel to the original Fast and the Furious, Too Fast, Too Furious, in 2003. And he's also done Four Brothers in 2005. Recently, he's gotten into some television. He's gotten involved with the Fox television series Empire. There's also American Crime Story, some behind-the-scenes action. He's directed an episode of two of each one of those. Boyz N the Hood, of course, he kicked in the door for the new age of black cinema that occurred in the 90s, and this put him on the map, and he pretty much stayed on the map for the most part as he his films became very critically acclaimed. Some were even financially successful. In terms of Boyz N the Hood, of course, we take a look at some of the impact there, like the critical response to it. I mean, it was overwhelmingly favored by critics, 96% on Rotten Tomatoes, 73 out of 100 on Metacritic. It's been referenced in many works. It has a big cultural impact. It's been referenced many times in other works, like music and television and movies. Definitely a big cultural impact for this, and so much so that the U.S. Library of Congress has deemed the film culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant, and they selected it for preservation in the National Film Registry. So this is a like you said, a benchmark, a landmark, whatever you want to call it, in African American cinema. And and of course, with the Best Director category of this upcoming Oscar season, we got Jordan Peele in there. You kind of can draw a line there between John Singleton and a young guy like Jordan Peele in terms of some inspiration or an impact that maybe that film had on future African American directors.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, not to give too many spoilers about Black Panther that I just saw last night, because Lord knows if you spoil a Marvel movie even like 3 weeks after it's come out, people will be incensed about finding out there was a villain in a Marvel movie or whatever. But yeah, no, I mean, what I was saying earlier about a lot of black coming of age films have that dynamic of the kid with the future and the kid without, Learning Tree and Cooley High, Boyz N the Hood, all of that. Black Panther has that book, like that mirror image bookend kind of structure. Black Panther is very immersed in that. You could actually, like, I would draw a very specific line from Singleton to Ryan Coogler, and I haven't seen Creed yet. I've really got to get on that at some point, but I'm sure that has based on what I saw on Black Panther last night, that has a similar element. The kind of language that came from those films, and to an extent, they're in other coming of age films, because even like Stand By Me had that to a certain extent with the main two kids, one being the sort of sensitive writer and one being the juvenile delinquent that no one expects anything from. It's interesting that Singleton picked up on that connection, because Stand By Me is sort of the definitive like young white boy wonderment approaching like the adult world coming of age film, and finding that structural connection is really interesting.
Yeah. And I also want to say about some of the casting. I mean, we mentioned the main cast of Cuba Gooding Jr., Ice Cube, Morris Chestnut, Lawrence Fishburne, of course, is probably the most acclaimed member of the cast. I mean, he's been in some... He's a fine actor, Lawrence Fishburne. I guess the surprise really is... with Ice Cube and where his career would go, you know, in Hollywood, not just, you know, musically. Of course, we all know what he's done musically, but from an acting standpoint, here's Ice Cube, man, who really, I think he really, you know, hit a home run with this movie and really turned some heads, and he's actually had a surprising amount of longevity in Hollywood in terms of acting roles, and probably accredited to his performance in this. It was very strong, and I mean, here's a guy who's done, of course, family comedies with stuff like Are We There Yet? And things of that nature. But he's also, he also did the XXX sequel. Ill-advised, but, I mean, he's gotten some big-budget money roles. Just based on, I guess, I want to give credit to Boyz N the Hood for really, you know, making Hollywood take notice of the acting skills of Ice Cube.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because... Because Singleton specifically wanted Ice Cube for that role and really, like, wore him down to the point where he was going to... Because he wasn't really sure about it. And, you know, all of that's interesting because at this point, like, the studios and producers were so still blind to, like, to rap and hip-hop that they didn't recognize that having a member of NWA in your movie was actually a marketable selling point.
Yeah.
Where, like... They just knew that Do the Right Thing was a big hit and was, you know, a really of the moment like big part of the film landscape conversation movie.
Yeah.
That this could had the potential to be the same. They didn't realize, oh my god, first of all, Ice Cube here is huge. Second of all, we can actually make a lot of money on the soundtracks to these films, which would become an increasing part of like 90s black cinema, the more Hollywood sort of crossed over with it.
Yeah.
Here we should mention that the soundtrack is provided by legendary musician Stanley Clarke. If you've ever grown up with a friend, or in my case a father, who plays bass, you will never hear the end of Stanley Clarke. First of all, he's an absolute legend.
Yeah.
But you know it's okay. It's a case where I'm not sure what it was that prompted Singleton to immediately think of Ice Cube over like, you know, maybe other actors that he knew personally, or, you know, that he was a fan of. But obviously, like, Ice Cube managed to parlay it into such a huge career, and Singleton was the one who encouraged him to, like, branch out and make his own movies, which led to Friday, which is, you know, probably one of the... I mean, I wouldn't call it the biggest comedy of the past, like, 20-some-odd years, but it's...
Huge cult following for that film.
It's probably up there, like, Big Lebowski is, like, one of the definitive 90s comedies.
Yeah, I mean, you can't go too far on the internet without coming across a meme from Friday.
I mean, we still have Bye Felicia in our culture.
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, we had Morris Chestnut and Cuba Gooding Jr. in this movie, and for a while it looked like Cuba Gooding Jr. was going to have himself a pretty impressive career. It kind of fizzled out there in the mid to late 90s in terms of roles that he appeared in. He's still doing things today, but more on the B-movie circuit. And Morris Chestnut, another guy, I mean, I can remember him from Under Siege 2.
Dark Territory.
Yeah, Dark Territory. But, another guy, two guys there that Ice Cube really, and they were the central figures of the film, but Ice Cube in terms of career output, in terms of filmography, has really, I guess, surpassed the two of them.
Which is interesting. I mean, you know, Cuba Gooding Jr., for a while, it looked like he was going to be the next big thing. I mean,
yeah.
You know, right after this, he's in A Few Good Men. He, like, shows up in Outbreak a few years later. And then, of course, he wins the Oscar for Jerry Maguire.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's still, like, a fixture of movies and TV. He still gets roles in big stuff. He was in The Butler. He was in American Gangster. I think, like, recently, he was in Selma. I think recently he was O.J. Simpson on American Crime Story and was nominated for some awards for that. So he's still, his career is probably resurging a bit. For a while, he was almost a joke, which is interesting because he was sort of like shorthand for like a one-hit wonder actor.
Yeah.
Because, you know, he won the Oscar for Jerry Maguire, which, yeah, quite frankly, like, props to him, that movie is terrible. But he also, you know, if there was a good part of that movie, it was him. So it was the award for making a Tom Cruise film tolerable.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, he was it's a case where he still continued to make good films or be the best part of a bad movie like Pearl Harbor. But, like, yeah, he made, like, reasonably good stuff, like Men of Honor. But, you know, he's sort of got typecast as the actor, as, like, the good-natured actor who just shows bad roles repeatedly because of stuff like Boat Trip and Radio and, like, Daddy Day Camp. And I think he was in Snow Dogs, of course. So he just kind of became like a punchline for a while. I think he's gotten away from that, but it was a rough like decade for him for a while.
Yeah, and that's why I have the Ayatollah on the show, because he can set me straight. Here I thought, you know, Cuba Gooding Jr. is the guy whose career fizzled, but yeah, no, Joel corrects me and says that his career is kind of on the rebound.
It's getting there. I mean, you know, he's always really reliable for, like, a decent performance with a lot of energy. Like, you know, he's got a very genial sort of demeanor, so which was part of his downfall because he's the guy you could credibly stick in, like, a crappy family comedy.
Right.
And he feels totally, like, in place in one of those, even though he could do much better work. Nice. Yeah, I think part of the problem for him probably was that he has such a boyish, youthful face. So for a while, like, they don't cast guys with that face in serious roles. Like, Lawrence Fishburne has, like, you know, he's younger looking than he is a lot of the case, but he has that very, like, hard-jawed, masculine face. He can be an action guy, or he can be, like, a dramatic lead.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think we're reaching a wrap-up point here with Boyz N the Hood, Joel. So I'm just going to provide my final thoughts on this in terms of what I thought of it. Of course, it's a powerhouse of a movie, social drama. I would consider it the most impressive of the movies coming out of the 90s black cinema scene. John Singleton, fantastic debut. He also wrote it, so his scenes of, like, street life dotted with, you know, some moments of humor, and there's some poignancy there, and before we get the full emotional force of the climax there. So Boyz N the Hood, definitely a benchmark film in African-American cinema. And in cinema in general, I think this is this film is actually, like, overall a classic and should be considered one of the best films of all time, really.
Oh yeah, I mean, this is like first of all, benchmark 90s film. I mean, this is the kind of film that just defines that decade in filmmaking when we were getting another you know, sort of resurgence of younger like directors with very individual voices. Like, I mean, obviously the one who sort of came out of that the most successful was unfortunately Tarantino, because you know, he was easier to digest and he pandered to everyone's innate stereotypes. where Boyz N the Hood is remarkable to me because, of course, it uses those as a starting point, and that might seem even more to us today to be like the starting point, because this is cinematic language and cultural tropes that this film codified, stuff that, like, you know, we, after years of being used to gangster rap, after years of gang films, after years of Tupac and Biggie and East Coast, West Coast, like, if you lived through the 90s like I did, this is all stuff that, like, is ingrained in you, but, you know, it was so new at the time. And it's not just those things, it's not just those broad tropes. I mean, there's so many small, authentic moments that seem culled from, like, you know, a slice of life, like, naturalistic film, like Killer of Sheep. Like, there's this moment I love because it's so goddamn true, where, like, he's at, where Trey answers the phone, who dis, and it's his mom, and she's like, what kind of way is that to answer the phone? And he passes the phone off to Furious, who answers, who dis? Like, it's such a great authentic moment, because, like, of course, just that's such a universal thing, the way, like, kids, without even realizing it, replicate, like, little quirks of their parents or siblings, but especially, like, a really important father figure or mother figure. Like, of course, like, the fact that even a small thing, like, they answer the phone the same, yeah, is so awesome. And it just, like, the clash of different, like, cultural signifiers, like, it's so self-aware that these characters are stranded between boyhood and manhood and have no idea how to proceed, in a way that I think a lot of the films that came after this really never reckoned with. It just sort of took being in gangs and the sort of exploitative, like, really visual elements, all the violence, all the sex, like, the drugs, all the cool, like, grindhouse movie shit, it took at face value.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. And so, Joel, we've come to the end of Boyz N the Hood, and we got to wrap it up here. And the second half of our coming of age themed show, inspired by Lady Bird, I can't help but crack up at that. Just, you know, go from Lady Bird to Gregory's Girl to Boyz N the Hood. And,
hey, we're the number one podcast of white boys talking about Boyz N the Hood.
Yes, we are, and we appreciate your support. But we got to move on. We've got some new retro releases coming out this week, Joel. It's the Blu-ray DVD delivery week, February the 27th, and when we're seeing some of these releases. We've got the We've got some decent ones on the list this week that we want to check out. I think we'll start from the top, because Disney, we love Disney. Disney's coming out with 20th anniversary editions of Mighty Joe Young, which is a King Kong knockoff, so to speak, a remake of a film from the 40s with Charlize Theron in it. And Rocket Man, with one of my personal favorite comedians, Harlan Williams. And I've seen both films. It's been a while since I've seen either film, but Mighty Joe Young was unremarkable enough for me to forget anything that happened in it, other than a king-sized gorilla. And
if you wanted to see what Charlize was doing when she was still an up-and-coming young starlet and not the absolute legend she is now, like the poor... The poor woman was in Mighty Joe Young with Bill Paxton.
It was Bill Paxton. That's right. Yeah, and of course I've seen Rocket Man, and Harlan Williams. That whole movie is Harlan Williams, because Rocket Man is such shit. it's not a good movie, but Harlan Williams makes it enjoyable because he's just so off kilter and so off the wall. And I'm disappointed that the guy really didn't parlay that into a bigger Hollywood comedy career. But of course, he came along in a time when Jim Carrey was king at the box office, or was just becoming king at the box office, really. And so Harlan kind of got shuffled into the background a little bit, became kind of like a comedic bit player. But for being a starring role, I guess maybe it wasn't suitable for him. He's better off being that memorable bit character player rather than a leading man, because he has to have a romantic interest. In this case, it's Jessica Lundy here in Rocket Man. But yeah, I don't know. I'll probably take a pass on Rocket Man, but I do remember it was memorable for me because of Harley.
Yeah, Harley's an interesting case where he probably got the chance to head a feature film because they wanted another Jim Carrey.
Exactly. Because,
but at the same time, like, yeah, Jim Carrey's weird and manic, but, I mean, how hard is it to make kids laugh by talking out of your butt? Like, it's pretty foolproof. You know, idiot young boys eat that stuff up, and I can attest to that because I was the kind of idiot young boy eating that stuff up. Harlan Williams is truly off kilter in ways that, like, Jim Carrey's probably capable of, but his stuff was, his, like, mainstream stuff really never hit that kind of true strangeness. I mean, most of it is just, like, a little kid vying for your attention. Harlan Williams, he's more of a Toby Huss type, if AMR listeners are familiar with him from The Adventures of Pete and Pete, where, like, his stuff is coming from places you don't ever expect.
Yeah, and I think I'm going to go on a search for some Harlan Williams stuff after the show, Joel, because I kind of miss seeing the guy on a regular basis, and I just want to go back and check out some of his funnier moments. And I remember his cop scene in Dumb and Dumber, where he drank the bottle of piss, and just his facial expressions and his tics in that scene just really, really sold it for me. So I want to go back, and I think I'll go look for some Harlan Williams stuff this coming week. We've got a couple of other movies here to discuss. From 1995, Code Red, putting out Serpent's Lair, a movie that I'm not familiar with. I don't know. Have you seen Serpent's Lair, Joel?
I have not, no.
I think it's one of those 90s... Just the 90s were so bad for horror films, especially in the mid part of the 90s before stuff like Scream came out. Horror and sci-fi in the mid-90s was strictly direct-to-video, B-level material for the most part. And I don't think this... Yeah. I don't think this is any different. So it's kind of an odd choice for Code Red, I think. To pull something out of the bottom of the barrel like that and redo it.
They've had some success with, like, weird 90s horror. I mean, I think Code Red was the first company to release a DVD of Psycho Cop Returns, and I don't know if Serpent's Lair may have, like, made the USA up all night circuit like that did. I mean, I know it's, like, it's a succubus film, and the mid-90s was weirdly full of I'm Afraid of Woman films like this and Species.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what was happening there, but it does have the Lawnmower Man himself, Jeff Fahey, in the lead, so
Jeff Fahey, the king of the direct-to-video box office in the 90s in terms of in terms of horrors and cop thrillers.
Oh, he was the Don the Dragon Wilson of direct-to-video horror. if you needed a serious white guy for your, like, B-level psychosexual horror film, by God, Jeff was there.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was. He made his money. Scorpion Releasing, putting out The Sect, or also known as The Devil's Daughter, from 1991. Another film that I have not had the privilege of seeing. Well, maybe it's not a privilege. It could be a shitty movie for all I know.
Well, it does have a little bit of a pedigree because it was directed by Michel Sovi. I'm probably butchering that pronunciation, but the man who directed, loopy, weird horror classic Cemetery Man.
Oh, okay.
Also directed the Italian slasher film Stage Fright Aquarius, and The Sect was... written by Dario Argento, so there be something to this. I don't know. I mean, certainly, those are obvious reasons why they go out of their way to release it, because it does have that pedigree. I mean, it's even got Giovanni Radice in a small role. You know, it could be a a lot of those sort of forgotten 90s Italian films have been released lately.
Yeah. So, yeah, there's been a wave of releases for those lately, you are correct.
And it's almost understandable why it took so long, because a lot of these films have been, like, you know, good directors at the absolute bottom of their game. Like things like Argento's Trauma and films like that. But
yeah, this is early 90s, and the 90s were really, like, saw such a downturn in quality horror. And, you know, a lot of handy directors in that realm from, like, the 70s and 80s were really scraping the bottom of the barrel for material at this point.
Yeah, and Soapy, I mean, yeah, he was a bit younger than his colleagues in the Italian horror film scene, so he came up sort of after that boom was over. You know, I mean, Cemetery Man is his masterwork. I'm not as high on it as a lot of Italian horror film fans, but it's a totally unique vision. And, you know, I haven't seen too many of his, like, I've seen Stage Fright, I've seen The Church. I didn't think either was that good, but it also, those were clearly, like, a young director figuring out what the hell he was doing.
Yeah.
In terms of, like, sort of an identifiable style. And The Sect, or The Devil's Daughter, is the film between The Church and Cemetery Man, so I'm actually really curious to see how he progressed from the one to the other, because The Church is just, like, a generic Demons-style film, like, generic Italian horror, and Cemetery Man is so its own thing. I'm curious to see where the change happened, and if this actually reflects any part of that.
Yeah, okay. So maybe a bit of interest in The Sect from Scorpion releasing. I want to mention that MVD Visual, we mentioned this one on the last show. Special Collector's Edition of Black Eagle from 1988. I think this is I think maybe it got pushed back, or maybe this is a different version that they're releasing of Black Eagle. But as mentioned last time, this is Sho Kosugi.
Yes.
Meeting Jean-Claude Van Damme in what can only be epic awesomeness. Of course, early Van Damme is kind of hard, you know, a little hard to watch at times, but, you know, he's got Sho Kosugi to hold his hand along the way, who's always awesome in everything he's in. So we'll give Black Eagle a check out here. But the next one I want to get to, Joel, is considered a horror classic. Arrow Video, always putting out some good stuff. From 1982 is Basket Case. And we've got a couple of different versions, a limited edition, and then there's a Diabolic DVD exclusive that comes with a pin. I can only hope that the pin is in the shape of a basket with some creepy eyes and a hand sticking out.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the pin looks like, but yeah, that's one of the weirder trends in horror fandom the past couple of years I've noticed, and even I've fallen prey to it, is the vogue for enamel pins of things.
Yeah.
Like, I have more than a few myself at this point. But, yeah, what the hell, if you're a Basket Case fan, and yeah, believe me, I've bought plenty of DVDs and Blu-rays off Diabolic DVD. Yeah, they're a great little company. I think Pennsylvania-based, if I recall. They make the rounds at some of the horror conventions in the Northeast, and they're always great. Their customer service is great. Like, they stock some incredibly strange and rare stuff. Like, I bought a lot of German DVDs of Godfrey Ho films from them.
Oh yes, if only Godfrey Ho had directed Basket Case.
Oh my god, it could not be. I'm not sure it could be Stranger, but Godfrey would probably find a way. I mean, yeah. You know, it's a total, like, grindhouse, trash, low-budget, weird classic. I mean, Hennenlotter is such a strange filmmaker, and, you know, he makes the absolute grossest, just most offensive stuff incredibly funny and bleak at the same time. I mean, you know, that kind of director, like, existed in the 80s and doesn't really seem to exist much now. There are a lot of guys who like copy that style in these pseudo grindhouse films.
Yeah,
you know, something like Hobo with a Shotgun was good, but there's a lot of lesser films that tried to take that style, or you know, tried to be like low budget Tarantino or whatever. I mean, guys like Hayden Lauder and Stuart Gordon, Don Coscarelli, like
we just don't get artists like those guys anymore.
It just absolutely like weird artists who can do these kinds of strange, like trashy films, but imbue them with cleverness and even some kind of meaning sometimes. And Basket Case is a film with like, you know, it's a strange film about obsession and about like dysfunctional family, and it's, and you know, so much of these films, they're about like Basket Case or From Beyond or Rami or what have you, Frankenhooker, they're about that sort of cross link between the body and the mind and deterioration on both sides. I mean, just strange individual films, body horror in the funniest and most unique ways. Basket Case is a great movie. I mean, it's not great in the way like Gregory's Girl or Boys in the Hood is great, but it's great in the it's great in the way that only Basket Case could be great.
Yeah, exactly. We've got another one from 82. Kino Lorber reaching into the obscurity barrel again with a movie called The Soldier, starring Ken Wahl. We've run into a lot of Ken Wahl releases lately. Here's a guy, you know, I think his peak was probably mid to late 80s, or we mentioned a while back, The Taking of Beverly Hills, an action film, but here's another one with The Soldier. I'm not familiar with it, but Ken Wahl is one of those interesting stories of a guy who probably could have or should have been bigger than he actually was in the action realm, but never really got to those heights. Maybe because for talent reasons more than anything else, but this one from Kino Lorber, who usually, you know, we talked about them last time when they put out V.I. Warshawski. They're really just really reaching into these obscure and forgotten films and polishing them up and making them look nice, and The Soldier is no exception.
And The Soldier, you know, it's not a film I know much about. It's got like the kind of plot line that would seem to demand a Schwarzenegger or Stallone.
Yeah.
But it does not have a Schwarzenegger or Stallone. It has a Wahl.
Yeah, it has a Wahl. This comes at a time, you know, Stallone was doing First Blood. So Rambo had just entered the our cinematic vocabularies a little bit, and Schwarzenegger was still on the rise with Conan the Barbarian at this point.
It's an interesting moment because the director, James Glickenhouse, he's probably best known for the grindhouse classic The Exterminator, which was one of the Death Wish style vigilante films,
with a flamethrower, baby.
And the So he follows that up with The Soldier, and it's kind of an interesting moment where those kind of grindhouse vigilante films are making way for the big budget action spectacular. Like, The Soldier has that plot line, it's just not at that level or point in time yet, and doesn't have that star. I mean, at this point, Rambo is still a pain tormented Vietnam veteran. He's not the strapping an explosive to a bow and arrow kind of Rambo that we would know later.
Right. And so kudos to Kino Lorber once again. He have some questions about the quality of the film, but there's no question that Kino Lorber is providing a good service by finding this stuff and re-releasing it. So we'd love to see that. Another one I want to touch on. Vinegar Syndrome. We can't talk about retro releases without our friends at Vinegar Syndrome. Putting out from 1977, Prey, or it's probably better known under its alternate title, Alien Prey, because it has managed to find its way onto many, many, many different multi-movie sets, like companies like Mill Creek and Echo Bridge are used to putting out. I have a set, a 50-movie set, from Mill Creek that has Alien Prey on it. I have not sat down to watch it yet because, let's just face it, there's 50 movies on that damn thing, and they all have varying quality issues to them. But Vinegar Syndrome has probably polished this one up, restored it. It's a science fiction horror film. It's kind of like an alien coming to Earth. It's kind of like take the movie Alien. This predates Alien, of course, and just put the beast on Earth, and it's just basically the story of trying to put a stop to this alien creature who's massacring humans, hunting them down. So.
And of course, it's totally exploitative. Like, there's a there's a lesbian couple at the center of it, which is, I'm assuming, not there for progressiveness. it's there for the porno chic audience to get some girl on girl. The director is Norman J. Warren, who did a lot. Yeah, it's funny we mentioned Alien because he predated Alien with this, and yet he also provided one of the all-time great bad alien ripoffs with Horror Planet, also known as Inseminoid.
Oh yes.
So I don't know too much about Warren. I don't know if he actually did any pornos or anything. Like, I'm sure he probably did, but or at least had some kind of foot in that element, but his films do have an extremely like low rent quality to them. I've seen Inseminoid. I haven't seen this. I've seen one of his later films, Bloody New Year.
Oh yeah.
Which unfortunately he did not get to the New Year theme early enough to snatch up the title New Year's Evil, like the previous film. But Warren's one of those weird cases where he's a British director who never made the Hammer circuit. He only did like very modern, very sort of cold, almost sterile film. It's like when we were talking about Cronenberg last episode, he never was at Cronenberg's level.
Yeah, this is typical late 70s drive-in fare for the most part. So Vinegar Syndrome polishing this one up for re-releasing. And then another one I want to touch on. You might have a few more, Joel, but the last one I want to touch on from another Warner Archive release from 1975, The Drowning Pool, which I have not seen. I believe it's one of those movies that I probably need to get around to seeing. But I don't have any particular thoughts on The Drowning Pool, which I'll leave up to you, Joe.
Yeah. Well, I do like... I haven't seen it, but I do dig those sort of bleak, gritty 70s detective and cop movies. So yeah. I'm curious about The Drowning Pool. And, I'm a Paul Newman fan in general, and of course he's the star here. So, it could be story by Tracy Keenan Wynn, who wrote the screenplay for The Longest Yard. So I don't know terribly much about The Drowning Pool, except it does have sort of a cult following, and behind the camera, it's directed by Stuart Rosenberg, who made legitimately one of the greatest American films of all time, Cool Hand Luke.
Absolutely.
Unfortunately, he also made the Amityville Horror. So.
Yes. So you just proof that you can go from one extreme to the other, and not everything turns to gold. Especially after Cool Hand Luke, everything is going to be a step down anyway.
I mean, no one expects to replicate Cool Hand Luke. It's just there's not enough I could say about how great that film is. I mean, Paul Newman in the 60s is like the apex of what a Hollywood leading man can be.
Yeah. Exactly, and I think that actually sounds interesting as like a gritty, because I'm a big fan of the gritty 70s police detective dramas, there's always at least one good chase scene, whether it's a foot chase or a car chase, and being a fan of Paul Newman, I think this might be worth checking out.
Yeah, I mean, like that whole era of like Hollywood films, like a lot of these films are pretty smart. I mean, they're made with adults in mind. Like, kids were not lining up to see The Drowning Pool the year Jaws came out.
Yeah.
Not that Jaws isn't smart, but these are just like thrillers made for adults. Like, you know, they're usually like full of grit. Like, there's a certain level of paranoia to a lot of them. Like, they even make Robert Redford cool sometimes in like 3 Days of the Condor. So you know, it's one I've been meaning to check out. At some point we'll have to check it out and actually do an episode on these kinds of movies.
Yeah, we sure will. I may have missed some releases, Joel. So if you have any you want to hit up on, go ahead.
Just a couple. One I'm familiar with, and one I'm only familiar with a reputation of, because Scream Factory or Shout Factory has two fairly well-known cult films this week. The first is 1970s sci-fi film Colossus: The Forbin Project.
All right, yeah,
which I think mostly gets mentioned because you know, it's fun to say Colossus: The Forbin Project. But yep. it's sort of pre-war games, like losing control to supercomputers, like instituting nuclear war kind of thing. And I don't know how good it is, but it was directed by Joseph Sargent, who is a pretty quality director despite his later career. Because, you know, early, a lot of TV in his history, like, worked on Kojak a lot, Man from U.N.C.L.E., even Star Trek, he helmed an episode or two. He made one of the great 70s action films, speaking of 70s action, in Taking Pelham 1-2-3.
Yes.
But might be most known for Jaws the Revenge later in his career. I mean, not even really later in his career. I mean, he was making films up until last decade. He only died a few years back in late 2014. But you know, he was always a pro. Even Jaws the Revenge, I think a lot of the issues were more because the script was one of the greatest stupid scripts of all time, and they had budget issues. But yeah, I'm curious to see what he does with this, because this is, you know, in his peak a few years before he'd make Pelham, which is an amazing action film. Him helming a sci-fi thriller is the kind of thing I'd be curious about. The next film from Scream Factory is The Gate 2, also by Tibor Takacs. Oh, I'm sorry, would you say?
Oh, no, The Gate 2 is one that slipped my grasp there, because I would have mentioned that one. The Gate 2 is a well-known film.
That's right, we're getting The Gate 2, which, it's definitely not as good as the first one. I mean, the first one is a great, like, kid-centric horror film in the vein of something like, not totally Monster Squad, but it's in that realm, you know, sort of a fun, spooky, occasionally frightening kid horror film where you could bring like a 10 to 12 year old there and to see it, and he wouldn't be too freaked out. Gate 2 has more of an element of a Monkey's Paw story, a Be Careful What You Wish For kind of horror story, but it's a fun little film, and it's definitely worth checking out. I'm not sure if it did get a DVD. It was very long ago, and it's very out of print, so it's been a while probably since anyone's seen this one. The Gate itself has had a number of DVD and Blu-ray releases, and it's pretty well regarded by horror fans, but The Gate 2 is kind of a fun little lost curio.
Okay. Very good, Joel. And I think, plenty of interesting releases coming out on Blu-ray / DVD this week. February the 27th, as always, it's always Tuesday, new release day, so look for it this week on the 27th. There are no more video stores, so you may as well go online and look for them. And I guess with that, we've concluded another fine edition of Go Home in a Box, episode 34 in the books, only on the Place to Be Nation Pop Network, and we appreciate your support. The last several shows have shown us that there is support out there for this type of programming, and we appreciate it very much. So big shout out to everyone at Place to Be Nation and all the listeners. Thank you very much. For Joel LaPuma, I'm Chris Jordan. And until next time, just remember, there's no coffee in Nilbog. It's the devil's drink. We'll see you next time.
Oh my god.
Woke up quick at about noon. Just thought that I had to be in Compton soon. I gotta get drunk before the day begins. Before my mouth starts bitching about my friends. About to go and damn near went blind. Young niggas on the path throwing up gang signs. I went in the house to get the clip with my Mac 10 on the side of my head. Outside and I pointed my weapon. Just as I thought the fools kept stepping, I jumped in the flow, hit the juice of my ride. I got front and back, side to side. Then I let the Alpine play. I was pumping new shit, buying WA. It was gangster gangster at the top of the list. Then I played my own shit, it went something like this. Cruising down the street in my 6-4, jocking the bitches, slapping the hoes. I went to the park to get the scoop. Knuckleheads out there, cold shooting some hoop. Car pulls up, who can it be? The fresh El Camino low in Kilo G. He rolls down the window and he starts to say, it's all about making that GTA. Cause the boys in the hood are always hard. Come talking that trash and we'll pull your card. Knowing nothing in life but to be legit. Don't quote me, boy, I ain't said shit. Bored as hell and I wanna get ill. So I go to a place where my homeboys chill. Fellas out there trying to make that dollar. I pulled up in the 6-4 Impala. Greeted with the 40 and I start drinking. From the 8-ball my breath starts stinking. I gotta get my girl to rock that body. Before I left I hit the Bacardi. Pulled to the house, get her out of the pad. And the bitch said something to make me mad. She said something that I couldn't believe. So I grabbed the stupid bitch by her nappy ass weave. Started talking shit, wouldn't you know. I reached back like a pimp and I slapped the hoe. When her father stood up and he started to shout. So I threw a right cross and knocked his old ass out. Cause the boys in the hood are always hard. Come talking that trash and we'll pull your card. Knowing nothing in life but to be legit. Don't quote me, boy, I ain't said shit.